Okay, am I audible to you all?
Yes,
yes sir.
Okay, so today's topic is Liouville Trillings, Pride and Literature. It's very important article, and you see a very important discussion Liouville Trilling brought forward, especially during postmodern literary criticism. This theory is obviously based upon the psychoanalytic theory, and the psychoanalytic theory comes from Sigmund Freud's understanding of literature. So obviously the medical science branch of psychiatry is related to the literary criticism. And in this way, from Sigmund Freud, we got this understanding of literature from the psychology point of view. We heard from Sigmund Freud as to while he was treating his patient. So he prepared some, case studies. And from those case studies, he come to know about the relationship between human unconscious and human behavior. And while understanding those behavioral pattern out of unconscious, he realized there is a deep relationship between dream and the behavior. And on the basis of that, he brought forward his case studies and its analysis through his book, The Interpretation of Dream, published in 1900. And this particular book and the year is the mark for the beginning of psychoanalytic criticism in literature. Sigmund Freud's analysis has been heavily borrowed to understand literature. Although this understanding came from Sigmund Freud himself, because Sigmund Freud, he was having great interest in literary understanding from classical time to Shakespearean dramas, and from Shakespearean dramas till modern literature, he was undergoing the literature and he was understanding the thematic pattern and the psychological behavior of the character in various literary form. And while understanding those characters, he draws some conclusion on the basis of problems suffered by the character. And the famous one is Hamlet. Like we see, Hamlet suffers a great error in his personality, and the reason why he delayed his revenge upon his uncle, who was the murderer of Hamlet's father, Senior Hamlet. So why Hamlet was unable to accomplish his target, and then due to his procrastination, he later suffer his own death, or suffer his own, suffers his own death. Although he accomplished his target, but then he lost his own life as well. So basically, Sigmund Freud tried to understand the problem suffered by Hamlet. At the same time, he tried to understand the Shakespeare's mind to understand the beauty of drama, or the mystery of drama, he called Okay, so in the drama, he solved two kinds of mystery. Mystery of Hamlet and mystery of this drama, which was enjoyed by people. So in this way, Sigmund Freud influences many literary critics and psychologists who undertook the method devised by Sigmund Freud to understand literature. Contemporary to the Sigmund Freud, we see a great novelist like D.H. Lawrence. His novels were also seen under the scanner of, you say, psychoanalytic criticism. His characters also, Lawrence's characters also suffered, I mean, serious psychological issues. Like The Sons and Lover is one of the great example we can always quote or take. Where you see, Paul is also suffering some complex in his character. And that complex is called the Oedipus complex. I mean, it is the term devised by Sigmund Freud. The same complex was suffered by Hamlet. Hamlet was also having excessive attachment to his mother. And the same attachment, in excessive attachment, was seen with Paul, with his mother. And this was the reason why they have both the character like Hamlet and D.H. Lawrence's Paul in Sons and Lover had some serious behavioral issue. And this was the reason why the entire life has been affected of his complex. Coincidentally, when Sigmund Freud's theories were, you say, heavily been borrowed for understanding of literature, D.H. Lawrence was unaware of. Although D.H. Lawrence's wife and Sigmund Freud, they were quite a good friend. In spite of this, you see, D.H. Lawrence did not realize that his characters were having certain behavioral issues or complexes in character. Anyway, these are the, I mean, relationship, we can say, or relations of psychoanalytic criticism on literature, where sometimes writers are unaware of as to what they are doing are related to certain aspect of theory. So this happens with D.H. Lawrence. Okay, now the problem is this. What Leonel Trilling is understanding or is bringing to the discussion in this article, Freud and Literature, is this. From the advent of this theory in 1900, it was considered for understanding of literature by literary critic and psychologist. And then there was a tradition, or then there was a movement as initiate to go back to the classical literature, go back to the popular literature of the past, and then try to unveil the mind of characters and try to unveil the mind of writer. This was the process was there in the from the history. But then Leonel Trilling, I mean, see some limitations to this theory, as we cannot apply this theory as a general, you say, in as a general on each and everything. Now, what you see, Freud, I mean, take it as, you say, the method to understand literature, but this method may be having certain limitation, and that Leonel Trilling is trying to understand or trying to bring before the community who are heavily borrowing psychoanalysis. Because this mechanical process made, I mean, critic think about, I mean, you see, only scientific investigation. And in this process, we lose the very basis of pleasure out of literature. We read literature, we enjoy literature, we enjoy the pleasures of reading. But then through this scientific investigation, sometime there is a danger of losing these pleasures. Okay, then you cannot apply this theory on each and every incident, each and every, novel or each and every literature. Because sometimes some literature born out of some condition or some, incidences impacted some person in such a way that their dreams are related to those incidents in particular. So we cannot say that the entire personality, which is undergoing a kind of a complex, is not the product of that particular incident. It may be timed one. So those incidences are timed one, okay, they may be cured with the passage of time. And in this way, the claim came from the follower of Sigmund Freud, fell flat on the scientific investigation point of view. Okay, so this is a general synopsis of today's lecture. To talk about Lionel Trilling, he was born in 1905 and died in 1975. He is a famous American literary critic and a celebrity teacher whose criticism was informed by psychological, sociological, philosophical methods and insights. He was educated at Columbia University and he taught briefly at the University of Wisconsin and at Hunter College in New York City. And in 1931, joined the faculty of Columbia, where he remained for the rest of his life. In 1937, Trilling joined the recently reviewed magazine, Partisan Review, this famous magazine of the time. And it follows Marxism, but the magazine was anti-Stalinist. It was Marxist, but it was anti-Stalinist. So here you see, Trilling joined this magazine as an editor. Later, Trilling published two complex studies of authors. Number one, Matthew Arnold in the year 1939, and second one, E.M. Forster in 1943. Both these books were written in response to a concern with the tradition of humanistic thought and the intellectual middle class, which believes and continues this tradition. Trilling wrote one important novel, The Middle of the Journey, published in the year 1947, about an affluent communist couple's encounter with a communist defector. This is the storyline of this novel. So from this we can understand that Trilling was under influence of Marxism, but again he was somehow anti-Stalinist in stand. Trilling's breakthrough to a popular recognition came in the year 1915 when he published his article, collection of articles, The Liberal Imagination. And believe me, this essay revised from magazine articles and introduces to classic work of literature. And to tell you, this book sold around 170,000 copies. And it became so popular and made Trilling a very celebrity kind of a teacher and critic of the time. Trilling enjoyed such a period of history or time when literary critic like Twilling were enjoyed a celebrity position. Readership and in the university discussions, in seminar and symposia, such critic and super reader are highly been rated or highly revered. So they got a status of celebrity professors. So Leonard Trilling is one of them. Okay, now we'll go in the article. I have prepared some notes on the basis of that linearly. I mean, we'll go through article with some important ideas Leonard Trilling gave us through this. This entire article is based upon a kind of a discussion and argument Leonard Trilling bring forth. Okay, so for Leonard Trilling, the Freudian psychology is the only systematic account of human mind. In the beginning, he, bring forward the ideas of Sigmund Freud, and he talk about Freudian psychology. And then in the later part of this article or this discussion, he talks about the limitation of this system of psychology, advented by or introduced by Freud. Okay, so this entire Freudian psychology is a systematic account of a human mind, based upon human mind. Okay, as you see, Freud has given us the, compartmentalized human mind into three important sections: conscious mind, subconscious mind, and unconscious mind. Okay, and our behavior is related to our unconscious mind. Our language is influenced of, or language is related to our unconscious mind. Okay, your dreams and your fears, all they have is relation to the unconscious mind. So here, the point is this: to understand the subtlety, complexity of interest and power deserve to stand beside the chaotic mass of psychological insights which literature has accumulated through the centuries. Okay, so here you see Freudian psychology is trying to understand the literature to unveil the unconscious, brought forward by different writer at different stages. To pass the reading of a great literary work to a treatise of academic psychology is to pass from one order of perception to another. But the human nature of Freudian psychology is exactly the step upon which the poet has always exercised his art. Now here, this is a process. And the process is, poet has his own understanding of human society and human nature. He has his own, way of understanding and methodology to grasp the life, and then he expressed this through poetic, creation. Okay, so here you see, poet also understand the human unconscious, and the poetic creation gives us the human unconscious or collective unconscious, which Freud talks about. At one point, even Freud, responded to one query: if he is the discoverer of the unconscious, and Freud says no, it is the poet who is the one discovered human unconscious. He only methodologized it. So it is therefore not surprising that with psychoanalytical theory has had a great effect upon literature. Now here the point is this. Now what Leonard Trilling here is discussing: the relationship between and the effect of psychology on literature and literature on Freudian psychology. Both this process are there, and we are going to understand that. So here, Leonard Trilling finding it, this relationship of effects on each other is reciprocal. Okay, the effect of Freud upon literature and that the literature upon Freud. You see, a person like Freud becomes so, indispensable in this business that he has, obviously he has effect on literature. And then from that point of view of psychology also, writers were writing their creativity. But on the same time, you see, Freud also was affected of literature, and his psychology is also quite affected of. So therapeutic understanding of, you say, or the cure of psychological behavior. So he take, you say, clues from literature to treat his patient or to understand the mystery of human behavior. So this relationship between literature and Freud is reciprocal, as maintained by Trilling. Freud was regarded as the discoverer of the unconscious, but he refuted it, as I have just mentioned. And he maintained that what he discovered was the scientific method by which the unconscious can be studied. Unconscious was already unveiled by the poet themselves. For psychoanalysis is one of the calculations of romanticist literature of 19th century. Itself scientific, for it was passionately devoted to research into self. So when we go through the romantic period literature in Europe, it's not only in England, but in entire Europe. So you can see that the romanticist writers themselves were obsessed about understanding human mind. Now here, Trilling is taking us back to that period and maintain to trace the connection between romanticism and Freud, we need to go back as far as 1762 with the dialogue of Diderot's called Ramu's nephew. So he is bringing a discussion between a Diderot's called Ramu's nephew. The work was translated by a famous poet Goethe and writers and philosopher like Hegel and Marx admire that particular work, and even Sigmund Freud read it with a pleasure of agreement. The story of Diderot, now here Trilling maintains, it would perhaps be pressing too far to find in Ramu's Freud's id, in Diderot's Freud's ego. Okay, you see, I'm again taking you back to the compartments of mind, like conscious, unconscious, and subconscious. You see, within a decade or two, Sigmund's own follower, they found a limitation with this, and they bring forward like Adler is one of them, the psychologist, psychiatrist, who, and then C.G. Jung is there, who found some issues with Freudian psychology. Then you see, Freud revised his own ideas, and then he bring forward the idea of mind with id, ego, and superego. Okay, so our behavior has connection with id, ego, and superego. Okay, so on one hand, he gives us line of thought, a line of elements of like conscious, subconscious, and unconscious mind. At the same time, parallel, he brought before us the idea of id, ego, and superego. So here, Ramu's Freud ego, and in Diderot's Freud ego. yet the connection does suggest itself, and at least we have here the perception which is to be common characteristics of both Freud and Romanticism. The perception of hidden element of human nature and the opposition between hidden and the visible. So you see, what was the, you say, quest of Freud is to understand the element of human nature and to trace the opposition between hidden and the visible of human behavior. Okay, so he take clue from the literature, okay, and focused upon literature of Romantic period. The hidden element takes many forms, and it is not always dark and bad. Wordsworth, Coleridge, Burke, what was hidden and unconscious was wisdom and power. Okay, so when we understand poetry of these, I mean, great writers of Romantic period, so you see that their literature was on the basis of or taking clue from the hidden and unconscious, and that was the wisdom and power. So you see, when we read poetry of Wordsworth, we try to understand wisdom and the power Wordsworth was, you say, disseminating, or he was, you say, influencing the reader through that wisdom and power, working even in despite of conscious intellect. So you see, for Matthew Arnold, the mind was fed by streams buried deeper than we can know. So we again passed through the age, passed through the decade, and we came to the Victorian period with Matthew Arnold. For him, the mind was fed by streams buried deeper than we can know. So we are unable to dwell into human mind to find out where from our, you say, behavior and understanding came from. So it is much more, you say, buried deeper. We are unable to get into that. Poets find that this new power may be conspired against by other agencies of mind and even deprived of its freedom. Now, there was a quest to understand, like you see, sometimes we heard about as to why there is a quest to understand some intellectual scientist. Okay, we heard like Einstein's brain after his death was stolen, and then it was kept years in formaldehyde to understand his brain as to how he was so much intelligent, having great IQ than any other human being. So it is always the quest of human being to understand other mind. So here also, we get an idea, okay, like there was a process of understanding human mind. So here, the names of Wordsworth, Coleridge, and Arnold at once occur to us again. And here, Freud quotes Schiller on the danger to the poet which lies in the merely analytical reason. And even the educated and sensitive people became aware of the predation the reason might make up the affective life. So it is always a quest to understand the Romantic literature and to understand the relationship between Wordsworth and the nature, the bonding between them, which was very invisible. From his prelude to many of his sonnets, we try to understand his mind. And that mind takes us to the idea of transcendentalism. So we go to some Romantic writers of America, those who are highly influenced of Wordsworth and Coleridge. So that's very, the basis of this attachment was the transcendentalism. Trilling further takes us to the idea that this quest began in the 17th and 18th century with children and women, peasants and savages, because their mental life, it is felt, is less overloaded than that of the educated adult male by the properties of social habit. Now you see, there was a literary quest to understand the societies throughout Europe. Now the societies living in the rural setup and the societies were living in the urban setup. Okay, and here you can understand the very much differences. Okay, so you see the urban, minds are more under, you say, the complexes than the rural one. Again, in the novels like Bill Grossman by Wilhelm Meister, we get the most complete identification of author and hero, of reader with book, and this identification suggests leniency of moral judgment. You see, sometimes writer is highly influencing his own work, and he himself reflected through some character. And sometimes the hero and the protagonist is none other than the, made up of writer's own understanding. So here, Mr. Wilhelm Meister's work and his hero is identifying, writer himself. Sometimes autobiographical novel has a further influence upon moral sensibility by its exploitation of all modulations of motive, by its hinting that we may not judge a man by any single moment of his life. Now we go through someone's autobiography or biography, and you see the man who is the protagonist of his own life in book cannot be just through a single incident. But then we understand that why he came out with autobiography. Because maybe here he want to reply or respond to the errors he committed. Or again, he wanted to argue, or he wanted to reply to certain issues he dealt with in his life, which was unsolved during his lifetime. And here he find it is important to come out with those answers. But then when we go through those incidences, we cannot judge man at a particular event. Now I'll take example from the life of Mahatma Gandhi. Like, we see that Mahatma Gandhi was a young advocate trying to establish his career in Mumbai High Court. And in the very first case, he was unable to stand before judge, and he ran away from the court, handed over his case to someone else. So can we say that Mahatma Gandhi was not able to plead, or wasn't a good lawyer? From that particular incident, we cannot draw a conclusion about his personality. So there are many incidences Mahatma Gandhi narrated, and he narrated his errors committed in his life. But as a reader, we cannot take those errors as a reflection of his personality, although Mahatma Gandhi is a great man, influences the entire world through his, idea of peace and his peaceful movement to get India freedom. So similarly, you see, while reading, you see some element of autobiography or novel, we cannot, you say, pass on a judgment on a certain particular incidences is, I mean, influencing the personality of the character. We look the more literary affinities to Freud. Now here, what Schilling is looking into, we must mention the sexual revolution that it was being demanded by Shelley. For example, by Schlegel of Lucinda, by George Sand, and later more critical by Ibsen, the belief in the sexual origin of art badly started by Trick, more subtly by Schopenhauer, the investigation of sexual maladjustment by Stendhal, the quality of whose observation on erotic feeling are in direct line of Freud. Now here you see, Freud talks about sexual, you say, elements, which are, I mean, suppressed sexual emotions, which are related to the behavior of the man. So here, suppression of sexual, you say, sexuality resulted into certain behavioral pattern. Without knowing this theory and relationship, many of the romantic work, you say, revealed character. And now while the modern psychoanalytic critic, when they go back to that literature, they found the certain character is, you say, having certain, you say, suppression of sexuality. Okay, but again, this understanding has a limitation too, which Trilling is pointed out. The names of creative writer who have been or less frightened in tone or assumption would of course a relatively small number, however, have made serious use of Freudian ideas. Now here, Trilling is maintaining there is not a large number of followers of Freud who are working on the line of Freudian psychological system, but they are significant in number. When they are significant in their, you say, stuff. Like the surrealists have a certain inconsistency dependent upon Freud for the scientific sanction of their program. You see, in the beginning of modernism, there is a movement of surrealism was there in different art, including literature. So these surrealists, you see, some of the surrealists, they were heavily under influence of psychological theories of Sigmund Freud. Kafka, one of the great writers of our time, with an apparent awareness of what he was doing, has explored the Freudian conception of guilt and punishment and of the fear of father. So you see, in the literature of Kafka, he explored the theme of guilt and punishment. You see, sometimes some character, they are suffering from the complex of guilt and punishment. Out of their mistake, out of their mistakes they committed in their past life. You see, when we are child, we make mistake and father slap us. So this is a very general and simple thing we often and frequently say, and it happens with us also. But sometimes this, you say, punishment came from our father, impacted some character, and it impacted in such a way that, you see, shattered a personality. It shattered a personality, and the personality remained under, you say, dominated, you say, influence. And such characters are plenty in literature. Kafka is the one who is exploring such theme. Thomas Mann was always in the direction of Freud's interest has been more susceptible to the Freudian anthropology. So another writer is there, Thomas Mann, okay, who was always in the direction of Freud's interest, has been more susceptible to the Freudian anthropology. Okay, in this way, you say discussion came in the first part of this article and introduces what actually Trilling is going to bring forward into the further discussion. So in the first part itself, Trilling brought a very problem of the Sigmund Freud's psychological system. And obviously he is hinting toward limitation to it. Till this, we understand that in a very short period, Freudian psychology has been heavily been borrowed into literary discussion and literary research. So here, a question is posed by Trilling. How much of Freud's system is militantly rationalistic? There is a great borrow. There is a great endeavor was running to understand literature through psychological point of view. And then there was a result, a very shocking results we were getting, like Hamlet was an Oedipal complex case. So it's a very shocking to us. Similarly, the Paul of D.H. Lawrence is the Oedipal complex case for us. So there are, I mean, such they were unwilling such, you see, cases. And we were surprised to know all that. So what here Freud believes in positivistic rationalism. We are talking about how the idea of Freud were rationalistic. So as per Trilling, Freud believes in positivistic rationalism. And Freud maintains the aim of psychoanalysis is the control of night side of life. It is to strengthen the ego, to make it more independent of the superego, to widen its field of vision, and so to extend the organization of id. Where id was, that is, were all the irrational, non-logical, pleasure-seeking dark forces word. There shall we go ego, B. That is intelligence and control. So here, what Freud maintains here, the aims and objective of psychoanalysis, and to understand the dark side of human mind, because that dark side of mind, I mean, giving us some critical behavior, negative behavior. Okay, so here it is important for, you see, Freud to locate those impressions which are, you say, responsible for negative behaviors. So here, through this literary understanding, through the point of psychoanalysis, Freud is giving us this element of id, ego and superego that we have to follow. Now here, what Trilling is maintaining, Freud would never have accepted the role which Mann seemed to give him as a legitimizer of the myth and the dark, irrational ways of mind. Now here, if Freud has discovered the darkness for science, is never endorsed it. Now he never endorses it, that he has unveiled the darkness side, dark side of mind. On the contrary, his rationalism supports all the ideas of enlightenment that deny validity to myth for religion he holds to a simple materialism. Now it's very complex to understand here what he endorses and what he doesn't. G- great scientist of our day has founded so articulately and so fiercely against all those sophisticated with the metaphysics, the scientific principle that were good enough for 19th century. You see here, Sigmund Freud as a great scientist of our day funded so articulately. And you see, work like so fiercely against all those sophisticated with the metaphysics of scientific principles. Now here it is important to understand the Trilling's reflection. The strength is the fine, clear tendency, which is positive in the goal of therapy. Now you see, if a patient came to the physician and he will apply a therapy to the patient, okay, so here he has to look into the strengths, okay, through which he will pinpoint the weaknesses suffers by the patient. Okay, so here the strength is fine, clear tendency, which is positive in the goal of therapy, the desire to bring to men a decent measure of earthly happiness. Okay, so strength is the one which is a decent measure of earthly happiness. Now here, when we talk about approach of Freud, Freud is neither insensitive to art. On the contrary, not done he ever intend to speak of it with contempt. He speaks of it with an aerial tenderness and counts it one of the fruits, charms of a good life. Of artists, especially of writers, he speaks with admiration and a kind of awe. Perhaps what he almost appreciates in literature are specific emotional insights and observations. He speaks of literary men because they have understood the part played in life by the hidden motives as the precursor and coadjutors of his own science. Now, very important thing we understand from Trilling is this: Sigmund Freud has admiration for writers, great writers for their literature, because writers are the one who explored the human mind and takes us to the past, to the point where from the life has taken shape to a particular direction. How the weaknesses and errors of a man takes him to a certain disaster. So it is very important to understand literature from that point of view to correct ourselves. Like we go back to Aristotle, or we go back to the Shakespearean drama. So we see audiences when they go back to the home after watching the entire drama. So they would carry the impression and will correct themselves if they suffer any errors in their life. It's like parable. Like in parable, a story is woven around a very good personality, good character who falls from his values, and then he suffers a tragedy. So Shakespearean tragedy follow the same pattern. So what audience will carry? An impression. So Freud is also having this from the writer. So he has a great admiration for them. And yet eventually Freud speaks of with what we must indeed call contempt. Art, he tells us, is a substitute gratification and such in an illusion in contrast to reality. So on one hand, you see, Sigmund Freud has appreciation for writers, but on the other hand, he is little bit hard upon art. Okay, and he says ki art is a substitute gratification and illusion in contrast to reality. So here you see, this is what the contrary statement Freud has maintained. Unlike most illusions, however, R is almost always harmless and beneficial for the reason that it does not seek to be anything but an illusion. Now here, Freud talks about the illusion. Okay, now illusion are such element sometimes influences the literature. You see, few people obsessed with art never dare make any attack on the realm of reality. You see, reality is the one basis for literature, but sometimes our obsession makes us not think of those realities. We are not able to get that reality to pinpoint. So as for the artist, he is virtually in the same category with the neurotic. Okay, this is what the observation of Sigmund Freud. Okay, so he says ki artist is virtually is the same category with the neurotic. By such separation of imagination and intellectual capacity, Freud says, of hero of a novel, he is destined to be a poet or neurotic. So you see, the hero of a novel, hero of a drama, is destined to be a neurotic one. And he belongs to that race of being whose realm is not of this world. Now take example of Hamlet as understood by Freud and one of his followers, John, who undertook the psychoanalytic criticism on some of the classic works. And through that, they try to, point out that such characters are destined to be neurotic one. Now here, Trilling is giving us one example. The patient comes to a physician to cure his fears of walking in the street. Okay, now because of certain reason, a patient is unable to walk freely through a street. He has some fears of accident. He has some fears of something. Now here the fear is real and shows all symptoms on the patient. Now he could see that symptoms. The physician is accepting the patient makes a tacit compact with reality. Now there is a problem with the reality. Okay, and that problem physician has to solve. So the therapy will undertake to train the patient in a proper ways of coping with this reality. Now there is a training part. Counseling will be there and to make the patient understand the reality and he has to cope with it, that nothing will happen or this is the life, you have to adjust with that. So this way the therapy will revolve around the adjustment of patient with the reality. For Freud, two ways of dealing with this external reality. One is practical, effective. This is the way of conscious self. The ego, which must be made independent of the superego and extend its organization over the id, and it is the right way. So the antithetical, they must be called for our purpose now, the fictional way. Okay, now here, Freud is pointing out the ego, which is under the impression of superego. So here what Freud's quest is to separate ego from the impression of superego so that patient or the person will be free from his fears and terrors. Now here again, Trilling is giving some ideas or example from Freudian, understanding. And the most common and normal example of this is daydreaming, in which we get pleasure by imagining our difficulties solved, our desire gratified. Okay, now there are two kinds of dreams we experience. One, daydreaming, and another one is the dreams in sleep. So daydreaming, you can take example sexually, dreaming while sitting on a branch and cutting the same branch. He is very happy. with dreaming while he is becoming rich in his imagination, like that. But here you see that you are happy. You get pleasure while you are living your dreams. But you see, dreams in sleep, they are terrifying you. They terrified you in such a way that you got up with such a, maybe you say, terror. So you see, the dreams which are in sleep, they have some unpleasant and painful one. Now here for Freud, as psychoanalytic practitioner, we may say the polar extremes of reality and illusions are there. Reality is a honorific word, and that it means what is the illusion is pejorative word, and it means a response to what is not there. Okay, so what illusion is? It means a response to what is not there. Jo jahan nahi hai wo. Beside this view of mind stands the view which arises from Freud's therapeutic practical assumptions. In this view, the mind deals with a reality which is quite fixed and static. A reality that is wholly given and not taken. So Freud here insists on this view, although it is not easy to see why we should do so. For the reality to which he wishes to reconcile that you brought the patient is, after all, a taken and not a given reality. So here you see a patient who has come to the doctor. So here he is, after all, a taken and not a given reality. Okay, so here it is important to see the conditioning of the mind of the patient. Okay, so here this is the problem between taken and given of the reality, and one has to understand that. It is the reality of social life and value conceived and maintained by the human mind and will. Okay, so what we suffer or what we believe came from our social life. Okay, and there itself generates some problem with an adjustment, or you say problem with that adjustment causes for certain neurosis. The dream and the neurosis and art have certain common elements. Unconscious processes are at work in both, though in different degrees, the element of fantasy. But there is a difference. Charles Lamb maintained the poet dreams being awake. He is not possessed by his subject, but has dominion over it. Okay, now, while understanding the relationship between, you say, the dream, neurosis, and art. So, Trilling says there is a common, you say, traces Freudian psychology finds. And the process of art is the process of unconscious process, a process of unconscious mind. And again, here, Trilling quotes Charles Lamb, where Charles Lamb maintained the poet dreams being awake. He is awake while he dreams for his work. And therefore, he is not possessed by his subject, but he has dominion over it. So, author has a domination over his, creation process. Another example Trilling has given us, Jax Bartram's. What he maintained, a good analogy between art and dreaming has led him to go take false one between art and sleeping. So here, Bartram is pointing out the limitation to the Freud, the connection between the false and the sleeping. But the difference between a work of art and dream is precisely this, that the whole work of art leads us back to the outer reality by taking account of it. Okay, so here we understand that art is taking us to the outer reality of life. Freud's assumption of almost exclusively hedonistic nature and purpose of art barber him from the perception of this. So you see, sometimes Freud is seen as a barber because he is heavily founded upon the literary creation and taking a very forced ideas into analysis. So in this way, you see, this is something excessive on the part of, you see, Freud. For the distinction between artist and the neurotic, Freud tells us that the artist is not like the neurotic in that he knows how to find a way back from the world of imagination and once more get a firm foothold in reality. So when we talk about the creation of artist, he knows that he has to dwell through imagination and find a way out to come to the point of reality. So he need to firm foothold in reality. He cannot 100% live in the world of imagination. So here, Freud does not deny to arts its function and its usefulness, obviously, though he is heavily, analyzing literature from the point of view of mind and unconscious working of mental systems. Yet, he, does not deny arts function and its usefulness. It has its therapeutic effect in releasing mental tensions. It serves the cultural purpose of acting as a substitute gratification to reconcile men, the sacrifices they have made for cultural sake. It promotes the social sharing of highly valued emotional experiences, and it records men to their cultural ideas. Okay, so you see, the art is having therapeutic, effect on readers. And this is the reason why, you see, though it may be a music, painting, literature, many a time, readers, those who are having certain tensions, certain, frustrations, so they seek solace into art. They take solace into literature. You see, it is healing. Like listening to a music is healing. Okay, understanding painting sometimes is a healing. So in this way, Freud is agreement with this function of art. This is very much there. I think I have to close this part here. We are at the middle of this article, Freud and Literature. So remaining part of this essay, we will do in the next lecture. I'm closing it here because I need to give you people space to understand what we have discussed so far. And again, we need to give space to other teachers to take their lecture. And some lectures are scheduled at 10 o'clock. So the remaining part of this article we'll do in the next lecture. So okay. If you have any query, question, you can ask me now. I think this is very interesting lecture, discussion on psychoanalysis. I hope you people are enjoying it.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Anything you want to discuss? So would you mind today itself if you finish this article by evening? Because in that way, tomorrow I'll come up with another one. Or do you want me to continue tomorrow instead of today? It's up to you.
Sir, can we continue tomorrow as today is my son's birthday, actually.
Okay. Agreed. So,